So I will start with the introduction to programming, right? First of all, I would like to introduce you. Programming languages, right? There are three main kinds of programming languages. The first one is machine language, right? That the machine means the computer will understand the language, right? And the second one is assembly language. Assembly language will be the intermediate language between the machine and the higher level language, right? The assembly language will be depends upon the machine. I will talk about this later. And what we are going to study, that is a high level language, right? That is the code or the text will be similar to the everyday English, right? Or you can understand easily, right? Even you don't know about this, the programming language as well. And it can use the mathematical notation, and this one can be translated into the machine code by using compiler. So when you study about C language, you need to use C compiler. Okay, there are some examples of the high level languages. For example, C, right? That we are going to teach or we are going to study this term, C++, Pascal, Fortran, and Basic. And we also know about the Python, Java, JavaScript. Okay, they are all about the high level language. Okay, this is some example of the coding, right, in C programming, right? Like this, so you can understand about, because it's format or it's context is like English. Okay, this is a high level language. High level language means the language that the human being can understand. Okay, so this will be some descriptive definition of the programming language, machine language, and many things, right? This will be provided in your in the lecture note that I gave you in the lecture in the line group. Okay. In order to communicate instructions to computer, right? Humans need a language we call programming language. I just talk about this. But for each machine or for each computer, in order to communicate with them, you need to communicate by using the machine language. That is only 0 or 1. That is a digital format, right? That the computer can understand. But it's also different from one computer to another as well. So the machine language will be different as well. Okay. So we need some kinds of the intermediate language that we call the assembly language, right? That is a intermediate or the in the middle, right? To the machine language and high level language. And we are going to talk about this. But a set of these instruction or this machine language can be called a program, right? Or the dialogue, like a conversation. But if you want to communicate this instruction to the computer by using machine language, for example, add AX, AX, subdivide AX, BX, the format is like this, right? It's difficult for the human being to understand. Right, even we have some kinds of the comments, but this is the disadvantage of using machine language instead of the higher level language. That is a difficult, error prone, and non portable. Difficult means difficult for the human being to understand and write the program. Because it is difficult to understand, so when you write a program, right, there are error prone. Right, many errors in the program. And the last one that is important, suppose when you write a program, right, using the assembly language. Assembly language for MacBook, or assembly language for the Dell, assembly language for the Intel processor, there will be different kinds of the instruction. So you need to know new language every time. So that is not a good idea, right? Mm-hmm. So that's why we have to. Okay, to overcome these drawbacks, right, an assembly language will be used, right? But even we use the assembly language, right? Assembly language it's still low level language, right? So it's not, it's difficult to understand as well. So, and you need, okay, in order to compile the assembly language, right, into the machine language, you need to use the assembler. Assembler will be according to, will be decided according to the machine, okay, or the computer. So it's not so good as well. That's why we have to move to the high-level language, high-level programming language. High-level programming language is machine independent. What does it mean by machine independent? You can write a program, right? A C program, right? And then if you want to move or to port, okay, port is difficult. To move your program to be executed on Macintosh, so you can. And you can write the same program and then you go to the Windows operating system and then you can also run the program as well. So this is why we call machine independent. Do you get the point? Different machine, right? You can run the same program, right? But what is change? What is difference between different machine? What is the difference? How can we tackle this problem by making it to be machine independent? The difference will be only C compiler. C compiler will compile to the machine language according to the machine, according to the OS, according to the iOS, according to the Windows. Okay, so it will be less error prone and easy to understand and learn. Right? This is the best important thing, the best or the important things of high level language. Okay. Machine independent is the keyword that you know today. Okay. And then here we go to the C programming language. Because we are going to study C programming language, right? If you compare to the Chulalongkorn University, they will study Java programming, or some universities, they will use Python, right? But why? Only in KMUTT, right? And in every department, right? In every department in engineering faculty, the students have to study C programming language, okay? Even sometimes, someone told us, maybe we have the how can I say, the rumor for the C programming language. Right? It is very difficult to understand. It's not easy to write, right? And it's difficult compared to the Python, right? You may have some kinds of that. Today, I will tell you the advantages of using C programming language. Okay, first of all, I would like to introduce C, right? C must be noted as a high-level language because it needs a translator to convert it to machine language. Okay, we can use the C compiler. Okay, C language has a compiler to convert the instruction into actual machine code. Okay, that's right. But sometimes some researcher can classify C language as a middle level language, because sometimes in C programming, you can mix assembly code into C code, right? But for this course, I'm not going to tell you or to teach you about the assembly code embedded into C code, right? But I just told you that there is a way to encode the assembly code into C code. That is, you cannot find in other languages, only C, right? Why do we have to learn C programming? There are two reasons. The first one is C has been used for 40 years, right? To develop many kinds of utility, especially the system utilities. For example, the operating system. Okay, and because it's long lasting, right? So this language is well understood by the researchers, and also it has the drawbacks for the language has been eliminated already or eradicated, right? So you don't have to okay, you have to don't have to worry about some drawbacks or mistakes in the C language. Okay, and the second one, this is important. C combines portability across various computer architectures. Okay, that I've just told you that because C is a higher language, high level language, right? So if you have the C compiler according to that machine, so you can port from one machine to another easily. So you don't have to maybe to write a program or assembly program according to different operating system. Okay, let me tell you like this. You may have some experiences about how to write a program on mobiles, right? In the past, like if you want to write a program in order to run on the iOS mobile, like Apple, like iPhone, right? What you need to know is you need to use the Xcode, you need to use the special environment for the Apple. And if you want to write a program for the Android system, you need to use the maybe Java-based system and so on. So that is different. But nowadays, it's very convenient that you can use one language and then you can deploy into different architecture or different machines. This is similar, right, to the C programming as well. So it is very stable and mature language, right? That is the second reason that why we need to learn C. And when you know why do we need to learn C, we need to know the history. Because I'm going to run all of the time, right? So the history you can read it by yourself, right? Starting from Bell Lab, right? And Thomson and Dennis Dishi. Firstly introduced the Unix, the operating system and written by C, right? And the last one is C and so on, right? So you can read it by yourself. Okay, I'm not going to talk into detail about this, but the most important thing that I would like to address here, that is a feature of C language and advantages of C language. The feature of C language will be that's why we use or select the C language to be studied in this course, right? The first one is there are a small and fixed number of keywords. You don't have to know much about the keyword in C language. You don't have to know about the functions about that, then you can write a program. And the second one is C is very powerful and flexible language. And of course, because C is very powerful and very close to the machine language, so the program can run fast than any other programming language. The third one is that it is a low access, right? So you can access to every part of the computer. So that's why we use C program to write the system programming, like operating systems. And the fourth one, C program is very strong point because it can be written in module. I will talk about it later. And the fifth one is there are a large number of arithmetics, relational, bitwise, and logical operators. Because the programming language is very useful and powerful, right? So you can write anything, right? By using a small number set of constructs that I will talk about this in the next week. And all data has a type, right? It's fixed type comparing to Python, right? Python, you don't have to define the type much. Or even for the data type in Java, it needs a strong type, okay? But in C, right, it's more flexible. Okay, flexible in the sense of it, there can be the implicit conversion of the from one type to another. For example, if you want to convert from integer into the floating point, it's very easy in C programming. But or vice versa, right? But in Java, if you want to convert from the bigger one, the floating point or the real number into a integer, so you need to you need some spatial function in order to convert that. So this is important, but for C it's not that. It's very flexible. And this, the next one is the complex functions. I would say that C is very powerful because they subdivide the important functions into its library routines in different files. So you can understand the library if you know the function library that is described in a library in .h, right? I'm going to talk about this later, and you can use that function. So you don't have to develop your own complex function. Sometimes it has been provided in the built-in library, or sometimes there will be the user-defined library that can be also included into your program easily, okay? And the last one is because C is a structured program, right? So you can write a program that can develop the system software like OS, right? Like Windows, like iOS, for example. If you could remember, I don't know, maybe you know that, right? But okay, I will talk about this later because I'm going to run out of the time, right? And this is the list of the advantages of C language, right? The first one is easy to understand. Second, middle language, middle level language, right? I've just told you, machine independent, built-in functions, hardware control, easy to learn and use. These are the advantages, 8 advantages of C language. Basic for, if you want to go for the C sharp or C++, right? This is a basic foundation for C++ language. And the last one is a modularity. This is important. If you want to write a program that is a structured programming language, you need to subdivide it. You need to make it into the modules, small modules. You can subdivide the logic program into smaller units or modules, and then you can read, you can write it, this module separately. Okay? This is the advantages of C language. But also, if you have the advantages, you can also have the disadvantages, right? The first one is C is not OOP, object-oriented programming. Okay? And second, no runtime checking. No type checking, no concept of namespace. And the last one is a few constraints. If you want to check for the type checking, there is no routine for runtime checking and the type checking. Okay, so this would be okay for the nervous programmer. But if you are the beginner or non-experienced programmer, it would be difficult. But if you know more and more in C programming skills, you don't have to worry about this constraint. Okay, this is the history of the C language, right? Including the features, advantages, and disadvantages of the C language. Okay, now, do you have any questions? Okay, this is just the overview of the C language, right? Why do we have to use it? By the advantages. But now we go to the main knowledge about today's course, right? Today class, that is about the flowchart. I think all of you has experiences about how to write a flowchart in the high school already, right? Today I will just review you about the flowchart and then how to make the flowchart in order to deal with the design of the program, right? So I will have to start from the meaning of the flowchart first. The flowchart is a diagram represent the workflow or process which helps to solve a task step by step. Okay, this is the description of the flowchart, right? Flowchart is a picture. Pictorial representation, right? You need to draw it into the pictures. I would say that someone will ask me, why do we have to write a flowchart? Many programmers don't want to write a flowchart. I would say that. But I would say that this is not true. the good programmer you should write a flowchart to communicate with the other or with other people that don't understand the computer. Let's say that if you want to communicate with the person or the customers, right, and they don't know about the programming, how can we communicate with them? How can we guarantee that your program is correct or it meets to the system specification? So what you have to do is you have to write a flowchart. So flowchart is important. And also it is represented in the term of the pictures. Pictures can express more than 1,000 words. Okay, this is the poem. So you need to know how to write a flowchart because it is the flowchart symbol are universally recognized. Okay, and it can be accurate, efficient, and succinctly. Okay, so let me give you or review you about the flowchart notation. The first one is a terminal symbol. If you want to write a flowchart, the terminal symbol will be drawn, right? This one is you can write begin here inside this oval. In order to indicate the starting point or stop point or in the flowchart. The next one, if you want to get the input or output of your program, you need to use this one, this symbol, parallel pipette, right? And if you want to show the processing symbol, for example, if you want to calculate mathematical functions, if you want to calculate for text, right, you can use the rectangular symbol, right, to represent it. The arithmetic or the data movement instruction. This one is very useful. And the next one is a diamond. Diamond will show your decision symbol, right? This diamond symbol will represent the decision-making statement. Okay. And connector symbol, right? It can be represented to show from one page to another or to separate into the smaller module, right? You can use the connector, you can use a circle symbol here. And the last one is the flow lines, right? Flow lines can indicate the flow of the process or flow of the flow of the process in the flow chart, right? From the tails to the head. Right? This one is the head of the arrow. Right? Arrow will represent the flow lines of in the flow chart. Okay, let me give some example. Suppose I want to draw a flow chart for adding two numbers. What shall I do? The first one, we have to start from star symbol, right? Declare variable n1 and n2 and sum, right? Because we want to keep the summation of n1 and n2 to sum, right? So we have to declare variable and then read n1 and n2 from keyboard and then calculate n1, n2. Normally, if you have to use read, like you need to use parallel pipette actually. Okay, this one is not correct. And this one is the process. Process, you use rectangle, n1 plus n2 and keep the result into the sum, variable sum, and then you display sum. Display, you should have the what we call the parallel pipette. Okay, and then stop will be the terminal of this flowchart. So that's very simple. If you want to add two numbers, so you can write the program like this. Okay? Hanme? Can you follow me? If you can follow me, please press 9. I'm not sure whether, okay, I know, I've known that some of you are maybe study up in the programs about the computer before. So flowchart is very simple for you, but I still don't know you as well. I think there are some students who have no idea about computer, but at least I think they know about flowchart. Only for 46 students know about this. Okay. For the others who please try to, okay, after the class, you have to practice and try to recall this again. Okay. The next one, design a flowchart for finding the largest among three numbers, the largest number among three numbers. What shall we do? First of all, we have to start right from the start terminal, declare variable A, B, and C, right? Read A, B, and C, right? I've not yet changed this. Sorry for that. I asked my student to create this figure. Okay, I will have to. This is supposed to be read A, B, and C, okay? And it is. Okay, because you have this one, right? This one is you have PDF file. You can see that there are some mistakes in these examples. Please correct it. Correct it, right? Okay. So as I just told you, right? If you can write a program, if you can write, draw the flowchart, right? You have to know how to debug the program. If you know that there are some errors in this flowchart, you have to correct it, okay? In this one, you need to find the largest among A, B, C, right? First of all, you have to check whether A is greater than B. If A is greater than B, you have to know that, okay, this is has to be true. This is false, this is true. True, A greater than B. So you have to check whether A is greater than C. If A is still greater than C, so A is the largest. But if not, C is the largest. But if A is greater than B, it's false. False, so B is the largest. So you have to compare B with C. If B is greater than C, so B is the largest, so print B. Otherwise, print C. And then you may have to join this all together by using connection, connector that is the O, that is a circle here. You need to change this to circle. You get a point. And also this is supposed to change to true. This is supposed to change into the parallel pipette, right? And then you have to combine them together into one place and then go to stop symbol. That's all. This is the flowchart for finding the largest number among A, B, and C. Okay, we also have two more examples. You can check it out, okay? Okay, here we are. Here we are to the last one, that is pseudocode or algorithms, right? We also have what we call the flowchart before that can be depicted into the pictorial representation of the code, right? But we can also have the what we call the pseudocode. Pseudocode is not a programming. It's not a program. It is just an artificial and informal language that helps programmers to develop the algorithms. Sometimes we can call pseudocode. Sometimes we can call it algorithm. What does it mean by pseudocode? Pseudo mean artificial. TM, no? Pseudocode mean artificial code. It is a text-based detail, right? Design tools, right? Help you to write a program. It's not actually the C program, but it's more or less like a C program and very easy for the programmers to understand. The rules of the pseudocode are reasonably straightforward. All statements showing dependency are to be indented. Okay, so I will give you some example of the pseudocode. Suppose we want to write a program. If student's grade is greater than or equal to 60, so then print passed. Otherwise or else, print failed. So from this pseudocode, right, even it is not a C language or other kinds of programming languages, but you can understand that the people, the normal human being can understand this. Okay, can understand this easily. Okay, I will give you to the next pseudocode, right? you can write this set total to 0 and then set get counter to 1. And then y get counter is less than or equal to 10. So it means that we are going to perform 10 loops, right? To calculate the grade, right? Input the next grade and then add the grade into the total. And then you need to get the grade average, right? You have to divide it by 10 and then print the class average. Okay, this is an example of how to print to show the class grade average of 10 students. Okay, so in this way, the people can understand this because it is English. For the one who can understand English, can understand this pseudocode as well. So that's why we call pseudocode. But in this course, you need to know how to write both pseudocode and flowchart. Right? It depends upon the, if I ask you in the examination to write pseudocode, you can write pseudocode. If I ask you to write a flowchart, you have to write a flowchart. Okay? Okay, I think that's all for today's class, right? I just reviewed you about the flowchart, the pseudocode, and the course overview, including the curriculum overview as well, right? So here we go to the summary, right, of today's class, right? Starting from the programming languages, what does it mean by programming language, right? What does it mean by machine code, machine language, assembly language, right? How can we translate or compile a program, a high-level program into machine code, right? We use compiler. C, programming language, right, can be used in many kinds of application or system software application. And system software application, including operating system. Okay, and this one is a history of the C language, right? You need to read it again. And the flowchart, how can we write a flowchart in order to represent the system or the organization or the program? So I think that's all for today's class. Okay, thank you. Okay, sorry, sorry for stop the class a bit late for 8 minutes, right? Because I have many things to talk to you today.